A young wife and mother cut down in her prime.
She survived the surgery, but there will be deficits. We just don't know what those will be yet. She may be in a vegetative state or paralyzed, but she is alive.
One family's story of hope on today's 700 Club Interactive. On 700 Club Interactive, we use technology to pray for each other and explore topics that matter to you. Watch what God is doing in the world today. Well, welcome to the show. Throughout the years, we've brought you stories of miracles, people who have survived against all odds, even after medical science gave up on them.
Still, as we all know, life doesn't always work out that way. People get sick, accidents happen, friends die. So how are we as Christians supposed to respond when the healing doesn't come? For one family in California, the answer is hope.
Should I say hi?
Yeah.
Hi. That's weird. Hi. I'm Catherine Wolf, and at 26 years old, I had a massive brainstem stroke and almost died. Was that all?
My name is Jay Wolf, and what was the other question? I forgot it
already. Why am I talking to you?
So Catherine and I are both from the Deep South. We went to college together at Samford University. Freshman year, we met in the cafeteria, and we bonded over food there. I weaseled my way in to her affections over some time. After we graduated college, we had a huge blowout wedding that fall. Deep South, all the family, all the Southern fried goodness.
And that day, on November 6, 2004, began this just radical love story of devotion, of hanging in there with someone for worse, in sickness, forever. Words that our culture doesn't even understand today in regards to marriage.
Okay. Can you believe it?
Our life was wonderful. I was doing some commercial print modeling, and James would be booked on modeling gigs with me to be a mother-son team, and we were living a dream. All that changed pretty radically one morning in April. I was cooking, and my hands went numb. My arms went numb, my legs went numb.
I looked down at her pupils and they were completely dilated and black, and I knew something was really wrong. And I yelled and screamed over her, and I called 911 immediately.
It was a quite critical situation. The majority of patients that present with a bleeding of that magnitude and with a vascular malformation of that size, unfortunately die when they arrive in that condition.
The surgery that was supposed to last 8 hours lasted 12, and then ultimately 16. So I got by myself in the prayer chapel at UCLA, and I began praying and crying through the book of Job and Romans. The morning of April 22nd, Dr. Gonzalez came out into the waiting room as the sun was rising, and he was absolutely just tired and exhausted, bedraggled looking. And he said, well, she survived the surgery, but there will be deficits. We just don't know what those will be yet. She may be in a vegetative state or paralyzed, but she is alive.
Around 1 or 2 hours after finishing the surgery, I received a call from the nurses of the ICU, and I was expecting the worst. But the nurses were absolutely surprised. They were calling me because Catherine was following commands. They were asking her to show two fingers, and she was doing that. And I couldn't believe it. Normally that doesn't happen to patients that undergo a surgery of this magnitude. So I ran to the ICU to see her, and here they was. She was following commands, and that was the first of many miracles that happened with Catherine.
Waking up in the acute rehab almost 2 months after my brainstem stroke was surreal in every sense of the word. I just couldn't quite catch on. It's like, oh, okay, this is what I do now. I lay here for days and nights and weeks and months. And while I was okay and engaging and embracing my new life, there was this strange, horrible sadness.
Because of the trach and also some paralysis in her mouth and on her tongue, she really couldn't speak. Similar to her love of food, Catherine also loves to talk, as anybody who knows her would say.
So I would use a letter board and I would type with my working left hand letters, and that would speak words. So I would frantically, over and over, crank out on that letter board, I'm the same on the inside. I'm the same on the inside. I'm the same on the inside.
Almost 4 months after Catherine's stroke, made the decision to move to Casa Colina, which was a longer-term rehab facility. Swallowing therapist there sat me down and told me to prepare myself for the worst-case scenario, which was most likely for Catherine, that she probably never swallow again.
Eating is about so much more than just food consumption. Eating is life. Eating is what humans do. It's how they socialize. Now, you can't eat. It's very, very isolating because you're no longer a participant in life. You're watching life. So Joey and I returned to our little house right outside of the brain rehab, and my in-laws had flown in. Now, I looked up, and my three sister-in-laws are playing with my son. And I'm thinking, God made a mistake. I should have died. I can't eat. I can't walk. I can't take care of my son. My face is messed up. I can't hear. I can't see. I can't do anything. Surely this is not right. This is a mistake. And before that thought could even fully land, I had this moment of, Catherine, are you crazy? I know better than you know. I'm God, you're not, A. And B, I don't make mistakes. So there is purpose in all of this. Just wait, you'll see. And after over a year in that neuro rehab, I got to leave and I healed tremendously. Nothing was perfect. As you can see, nothing is perfect. And I doubt it ever will be perfect again. And actually, it wasn't perfect before. I was allowed to eat food again on March 25th, 2009, and it was a glorious day when I was allowed to eat after 11 months of no food. I began to walk again on October 21st, 2009, which was exactly 18 months after my brain rupture. In October of 2010, I went in for my routine checkup with my neurosurgeon. Now, this is 2.5 years almost after the rupture of my AVM. He held back tears as he told us that I have a small aneurysm behind my left eye. But I want to communicate to you that I don't hang out at that place of fear, of questioning what might happen. I think there's something profound about hope. I think there's something so meaningful when you cling to something beyond what you know and understand. And when that's in there, deep in your head and in your heart, and you believe it with every ounce of your body, something happens. Grit hurts the most. Hope heals.
Hope does heal. And hope is the key to faith. when you fall into complaint, into grumbling, into bitterness, when you fall into fear, that's when you lose things. Now, you look at Catherine today, and is she healed? Well, the answer is yes and no. You can't help but notice when you look at her face that things aren't right, that the nerves aren't functioning properly. When you hear her voice, you know. But a doctor will tell you that anyone who survives a brainstem aneurysm is a miracle. That anyone after a brainstem aneurysm can still walk, can talk at all, can swallow, can see, can hear, all of those things. Absolute miracle. But so often when we get into difficult times, you know, just like Job's wife, we want to curse God and die. We don't want to see what's the purpose here. Where can we find God in the middle of this? Well, this happened to the Israelites. In the 7th chapter of Isaiah, the king of Jerusalem, of Judah, had learned that Israel had made an alliance with the Assyrians to attack. And he was afraid. And he thought that his entire kingdom would be lost, Jerusalem would be lost, the temple would be lost. And the prophet Isaiah came to him and said this, "If you do not stand firm in your faith, you will not stand at all." When things get difficult, when life gets difficult, where do we stand? What's our natural reaction? Do we look for hope? Do we look, how's God going to make a miracle out of this? Or do you start blaming him? We start wondering, oh, woe is me. Why was I ever born? God, you made some kind of mistake. I should have died. Why am I here? Why am I going through this? And realize that if you don't have faith, you won't stand at all. Now, what is it? We talk a lot about faith, but what is it? Hebrews gives us a definition. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So in the very definition, if you don't have hope, you don't have faith, because you need the substance of things hoped for. And I like to say, well, you know in your knower that God's doing something, that he's working something, that he's working all things together for our good, that somehow in the middle of this, there's a purpose, there's a destiny, and how can we fulfill it? And where do we find that substance? Hebrews also tells us, how do we get faith? Well, you look to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Now look to Jesus as an example. Here's someone who lived a perfect life, never committed a sin, never did anything against God's law. And at the same time, here he is beaten, betrayed, abandoned, all of mocked, and then hung naked on a cross. And in all of that, he never gave up faith. The psalmist even records that after he died, his body rested in hope, because he saw what God was going to do. He looked at the joy set before him. So we should look for these things. Where's the joy set before you? What are you looking at? Are you looking at the difficulty of your circumstance? Or are you looking, how can God's glory be shown through what I'm going through? Faith can be elusive, but when you look to Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith, you can get all the faith that you need. The Bible also says faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word. And I like to add to that, who is the Word? And when you understand the Word is Jesus, that he's in it, that God stands by his Word to perform it, Then when you find those promises and those words get quickened in your innermost being, you start to understand that you have faith. But even then, when things get hard and when things get impossible, we can all lose heart and we can all lose faith. And that happened to the disciples. In the 9th chapter of Mark, there's a story of a demon-possessed child, and he would be thrown into the fire by these fits, and they went to the disciples, "Can you help us?" And the disciples couldn't do it. They couldn't see it, and they later asked Jesus, "Why couldn't you do this? Why couldn't we do it?" And Jesus said to him plainly, "Because of your unbelief." Sometimes you can have faith and unbelief in the same moment. So if you have to doubt anything, don't doubt your faith, doubt your doubts. The amazing thing in the story is the father of the child didn't give up. He didn't have an option. He had to get an answer. And for me, that's one of the keys. When you give up, then you lose it. But if you keep on pressing in, if you keep searching, if you keep knocking, if you keep asking, that's when you get it. And so he did it. And here's what he told Jesus. If you can do anything, so he's actually questioning, if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. Jesus responds, if you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes. And then immediately the father of the child cried out and said, "Lord, I believe, help my unbelief." And that's a wonderful prayer, to stand on your belief and acknowledge, I still have doubts. I still hear these machines in the hospital bed. I still look at this and say it's impossible. Jesus, could you help my unbelief? And can you get rid of these doubts? And can you give me hope again? And if you pray that with all of your heart, he'll hear, he'll understand, and he'll give you what you want. What he's given to the wolves is a great gift. The hope in the middle of a brain stem aneurysm, that can be yours. And that's what brought Catherine literally back from the dead. And I look forward to what God is going to do for the rest of her life. And if you want to hear more about the wolves, all you have to do to get updates on that family is to go to hopeheals.com. And still ahead, if you're going through a tough time and need hope, we're going to be praying for you. All of that is next on 700 Club Interactive.
Having some pains between my shoulder blades. At that point, everything changed. Diagnosis, pancreatic cancer. First, there was prayer. The second is to fight. As soon as we walked through those doors at Cancer Treatment Centers of America, all my anxiety left. The pastoral care here is based on the Bible, based on the Word of God, just as it is at our own church.
When you combine the great medicine with the spiritual resources we have, it provides the patients with something that really can make a difference.
You got a pastor right there on staff praying with patients, and whether it be scripture or whether it just be a word of encouragement to say God's got this.
If you or someone you love is fighting complex or advanced stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com. .com/faith. You'll learn how our treatment results compare to national averages and see a list of insurance plans with which we've worked. Advanced medicine and technology, the warm embrace of the Spirit.
I firmly believe God led me here.
Call or go to cancercenter.com. Cancer Treatment Centers of America. Care that never quits. Appointments available now.
Start planning your journey to the Holy Land. Come to Jerusalem. Breathe the air Jesus breathed that very night in the Garden of Gethsemane. Walk in his footsteps to Golgotha. Step inside the tomb. See the stone where his body lay. Glory to God, he is risen. Ask your pastor or visit GoIsrael.com to learn more about making the journey that will transform your faith in God and his word. Experience Israel. You'll never be the same.
Oh, well, before the break, we heard the story of the Wolf family who have found hope in the middle of trying times. And we're going to pray for you. And if you're going through a tough time, this is a time where we get to agree with you that God would bring faith and hope and substance to your hope so you can believe again, you can hope again, and understand that He wants to give you hope and a future. We've got some prayer requests. Reb writes in, "More than anything, my husband and I want to start a family, but we can't conceive. I want to trust God in the good times and the bad, but it's hard." Ann writes in, "My daughter lost her 9-year-old daughter to her ex-husband, and we've not seen her since. It's been 15 months, and my daughter cries every day. She struggles to find God in all of this. Please pray for peace and reconciliation." And then Debbie says, "My son is a drug addict and has been away from the family for 10 years. His father daily cries over him, which is gut-wrenching to hear. We're losing hope that we'll ever see him again. Please pray God brings him home. We want to love and help." And my heart just breaks over these and realize that Jesus sees it all. He sees your tears. He sees your heart. He sees your heartache. And He understands and He knows. We don't serve a God who's not touched by what we've been through and what we're going through. Now, hold on to this. He is our very present help in time of trouble. And He's willing to do things. He's willing to move all heaven and earth just for you. He's willing to leave the 99 to go after the one. That's you. He's willing to comfort you. So let's reach out to Him. Let's pray. If you don't have any needs in your life, join with us and pray for others. And if you do have a need, let's just believe God. And let's believe Him for the possible. When He says, if nothing is impossible to them who believe, well, start thinking, how big's possible? How big is that? How big is our God? How able is He? And let's just praise Him for that. And let Him take the load and give you the faith that you need. Let's pray. Lord, for these who have written in, we just lift up their needs to You right now. And for the granddaughter that's been taken away, for the son who's a drug addict, for the couple who can't conceive, Lord, just meet their need. In their time of crisis, let Your presence be felt. And we just ask now for the peace that would pass all understanding, that would be over them and in them. It would guard their heart. It would guard their mind. And Lord, we praise You for the deliverance You're about to give them, for the answer that You're about to give them. And Lord, for those struggling right now, for those grieving, for those wondering where You are, we look to You, the author and the finisher of our faith. We look to You. And we pray, just as that father prayed so long ago, Lord, we believe. Help our unbelief. And we ask now that all doubt, all unbelief would leave, that You would turn their mourning into dancing, that they would rejoice over what You're doing for them, what You're accomplishing for them, and how You're working all things together for their good. Lord, we thank You for this. Terry, God's given you something. Mm-hmm.
There's someone, you have a pretty severe curvature of the spine. It actually causes your body to bend to one side. God is healing that for you right now. You're just going to feel warmth in your back and even almost like a little current going through you. That's going to be straightened. It may take some time for it to be completely straight, but you're going to be healed.
There's someone you're just wondering, is any of this true? Is God real? Is this for me? And God just wants to speak to you in the middle of your circumstance. Right now, you're in a brace, and it's all around your head. I think they call it a halo. And you've got screws that are causing great discomfort for you on both of the temples. God sees you right now, and He's doing a wonderful miracle for you. You're going to get up out of that hospital bed. You're going to walk again. You're going to have life again because he's come just for you, and his presence is right there with you. Now just rejoice in what he's doing. It's just overflowing joy coming to you right now for what he's doing. It's a marvelous miracle happening to you. Mm-hmm. Just praise him for it and receive it now.
And for people with chronic pain, the Spirit of the Lord just sings over you now as he's setting you free from that. Just receive it in the peaceful quiet of your heart. Just receive it.
Lord, we thank you. We thank you for all that you've done, for all that you accomplished on the cross. We receive it now. In Jesus' name, amen. If you've been touched by God, we want to share in your good report, so just give us a call. Number's toll-free, 888-777-1999. And if you need prayer, it's our honor, it's our privilege to pray with you. If you need someone to agree with you, it's toll-free, 24 hours a day. All you have to do is call us. Well, still ahead, how our viewers like you brought hope to an abandoned boy right after this.
Never saw it coming. Next thing I know, it was like an electrical charge almost to my leg. And then when I looked back, I saw the shark swimming away. So I was just in a pool, literally, of blood. And I remember thinking, this is how I'm going to die. He just gave me a total peace right then. It was incredible. I'm a firm believer in the power of prayer and what prayer can do.
The following is an important message for individuals and families who do not have prescription coverage or cannot afford to pay for prescription medications.
If you have prescription needs but have no coverage or ability to pay for them, finally there's a company that can help. The Medicine Cabinet. The Medicine Cabinet can help you and your loved ones with low-cost or even free brand prescription medications. Our advocate team is comprised of committed professionals with the experience and the know-how to service and help uninsured and underinsured individuals who cannot afford their medicines.
The Medicine Cabinet will take the time to work with your doctor. It's like having a new best friend.
Call toll-free right now so that you don't have to worry about where your next medications are coming from or how you're going to pay for them. We are a dedicated advocacy team that has spent over 10 years helping our members by working with the pharmaceutical companies to deliver brand name medications that you can trust.
To the people at the Medicine Cabinet, I just want to say thank you.
Call or click right now.
Imagine being 10 years old and having no one to look out for you. That's what happened to a young boy in Vietnam, but his story has a happy ending, and it's all thanks to viewers like you.
After his father died and his mother abandoned him, 10-year-old Hai went to live at a neighbor's house. In order to earn his keep, he took care of the neighbor's cows.
It was fun to ride on the back of the cows, but then one of them got lost in the jungle. So I spent all day looking for it. I was so worried that I would have to pay for it.
Hai found the missing cow, but things weren't going well where he lived. He faced constant hunger and had to drop out of school to watch the cows.
There was not enough food at the house. When I was starving, I would climb up a tree to get some fruit to eat.
Then, a children's home supported by CBN's Orphans Promise heard about the boy and took him in. He no longer misses meals, and he was able to return to school.
The first day back to school, I felt handsome in my new clothes, new shoes, and new school bag. I am so happy living here at the children's home with my new friends.
Hai feels like he's part of a family again.
I love listening to the stories that our house parent tells us. He is like a father to me and takes care of me. Thank you, CBN, for helping me.
God puts the lonely in families, and he's done that for Hai. That's just one of the places that Orphans Promise is working around the world. If you'd like to be a part of that, we invite you to join us. Our number is 1-888-777-1999, or you can give by logging on to cbn.com. Gordon.
We leave with this word from faith that we've already gotten from Hebrews. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. May your day be filled with joy and hope and the faith that comes from knowing and looking at Jesus Christ. God bless you. We'll see you again.